Okay, we're going to get started now. Thank you all very much for joining us. We're going to talk for about an hour on the subject of Christian Zionism and Islamophobia, and we'd like to leave about an hour for questions. So if you can hold on that long, we want to get as much feedback and input from you in the audience as we can on this. Christian Zionism is not a subject that normally comes up a lot in Washington. The four of us are convinced that it's a subject that should be coming up a lot in Washington. It's something that we should be talking about more. I'm Phil Giraldi, for those of you who don't know me. I'm Executive Director of the Council for the National Interest, former CIA officer who's seen the light, and I'll be the first speaker. Christian Zionism and Islamophobia, as I said, is a subject that doesn't get discussed very much in Washington. In the United States, many believe that there should be a strict separation between religion and government. In practice, that separation has never really existed, with Christianity shaping government policy in many important areas since the founding of the Republic. In the 19th century, in a number of states, a nominally secular government existed side by side with collection of a special tithe tax to support the dominant Christian denomination. I will defer to my colleagues for a more serious and focused discussion of Christian Zionism, but I would like to make a few points about its political significance. Christian Zionism, by definition, consists of Christians, normally Protestant evangelicals, who believe that the Book of Revelations predicts that certain steps must be taken to bring about the second coming of Jesus Christ, at which point the believers themselves will be raptured up to heaven. Many Christian Zionists believe that the second coming will happen soon, and because the return of the Jews to the Holy Land is a precondition of that, they support the government and people of Israel completely and unconditionally in all that they do, to include the expansion by force into historic Judea, which would include what remains of the Palestinian West Bank. Another aspect of Christian Zionism is the belief that the end time, as they refer to it, will be preceded by an enormous battle pitting the forces of good against the forces of evil, in which all the evildoers will be destroyed and the righteous will be triumphant. The battle is supposed to take place at Armageddon, an undisclosed location in the Middle East that some believe is derived from the name of the ancient Hittite capital, Megiddo. That Christian Zionists believe the return of Christ is imminent and that there will be a major war in the Middle East preceding it would appear to be irrelevant to most of us. But it has in this case, real-world consequences because of the involvement of Christian Zionists in American domestic politics and their influence over some aspects of U.S. foreign policy. Evangelical Christians began to mobilize and became a potent political force in the 1980s. Many of the issues they supported were social, such as being anti-abortion and hostile to homosexual rights, but there was also from the start an identification with Israel and a sense that Israel had to be protected above and beyond the normal American foreign policy interests in the Middle East region. Through the creation of organizations like 2 Million Strong Christians United for Israel, or CUFI, headed by Pastor John Hagee, this focus on Israel obtained a mechanism for uniting evangelicals and providing them with a means and direction to lobby Congress to continue high levels of aid for Israel and also to resist any attempts to diminish support for Israeli policies. This mechanism was most recently seen in action on Monday of this week when 200 CUFI leaders were flown to Washington, all expenses paid, to lobby their senators against confirmation of Chuck Hagel as Secretary of Defense. I would suspect that if they had 200 people, they probably had four from each state, so they could lobby every single senator. Hagel has been criticized by the Christian Zionists as being less than completely supportive of Israel and hesitant to go to war with Iran on behalf of Israel. The focus on Israel coming from possibly as many as 30 million evangelicals concentrated in a number of southern and border states, the Bible Belt, has meant that few congressmen from those states feel it to be in their interest to question what Israel does. In fact, they find it in their interest to do the contrary and frequently express loud and long their love of Israel, which may or may not be genuine. This provides a political free pass to the Israeli settlements and also to Israel's aggressive foreign policy vis-a-vis its neighbors, which has damaged other American interests in the region. It also means that any consideration of Arabs as aggrieved parties in the Middle East, Fandango, is seldom expressed, even though many of the Arabs being victimized by the policies of Israel are in fact Christian. John Hagee has stated falsely that the Quran calls on all Muslims to kill all Christians and Jews. The persistent identification of Muslims as extremists, as enemies of Israel, and also as supporters of terrorism by evangelicals in general and Christian Zionists in particular, has led to a quite natural growth of Islamophobia in the United States. This prejudice arises from the perception that Islam is integral to the problems with the Arab world, leading to an unfortunate surge in those Americans who believe that Islam is an evil religion and that Muslims should be monitored by the authorities and even denied some basic civil rights or deported because they cannot be trusted. Because the Armageddonists believe that there will be a final confrontation with the forces of evil, it has been necessary to identify an enemy, and the enemy is all too often characterized as all Muslims. Hagee has construed this conflict as ongoing resistance to satanic proxies opposing the end time, and has already called on the United States and Israel together to attack Iran as part of that struggle. Israel itself has been quick to recognize the advantages to be derived from close and continuing relationship with the Christian Zionists, even though Israel's leaders almost certainly find the return of Christian theology, the end-time Christian theology, invidious, as all Jews but those who convert to Christianity will also die and go to hell when the world ends. When groups like Kufi organize their mass pilgrimages to visit Israel, they spend all their time in Israel, frequently refusing to visit major Christian holy sites in Arab areas or meet Palestinian Christians. When they gather in Jerusalem, they are often feted by Israeli leaders, including Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, who frequently speaks to them. Evangelical leaders, to include Pat Robertson and John Hagee, have also benefited more directly in other ways. The Israeli government has presented both Robertson and Hagee with Gulfstar executive jets to make their evangelizing more comfortable. It has, of course, been suggested that American aid and charitable contributions to Israel are thus being recycled to support those groups that are inevitably are willing to provide still more aid until the well runs dry in Washington, which may happen soon. So the bottom line for me is that the Christian Zionist involvement in American politics on behalf of the U.S. relationship with Israel does not serve any conceivable national interests unless one assumes that Israel and the United States are essentially the same, which is unsustainable. On the contrary, the Christian Zionist politicizing has been a major element in supporting the generally obtuse U.S. foreign policy in the Middle East region and elsewhere in the Muslim world. It serves a particularly narrowly construed parochial interest that, ironically, is intended to bring about the end of the world, possibly a victory for gentlemen like Pastor John Hagee if his interpretation of the Bible is correct, but quite likely a disaster for the rest of us. Thank you very much. You're up next? Okay. I'd like to introduce John Utley as our next speaker. John has been a friend of mine for many years. He's an associate publisher of the American Conservative Magazine. He's an advisor to antiwar.com website. He's written extensively on the issue of Christian Zionism. He was one of the first conservatives that I know of who began to address the issue of the Armageddonists and what their political agenda was.
Thank you, Phil, and thank you all for coming. It's a subject, as Phil says, not very much mentioned in the U.S., especially the irrational aspects in big media. I was at a heritage event some years ago, and they asked the editors of major newspapers in the United States, how is the 21st century evolving different to what your people imagined? And they all said, none of us ever imagined the return to religious fundamentalism of the great religions, the great Western religions, what happened and what is happening. I've been following, of course, we all know the Muslim fanaticism, et cetera, is reported all the time in the American media. But also in Israel and in the United States, we have fanatics that are pretty close on the same wavelength. If you will, the fundamentalists is not an exact term, not all, but these people all feed off each other. They each tell what the other, what they each quote what the most extreme members of the others say, and the three great religions have a constant, continuing dialogue among the extremists on both sides. I've been, although this is about evangelicals, I've been to J Street, the Jewish group that is against AIPAC and supports a just two-state solution in the Middle East. And if you put my name, J Street Utley, you'll come to my articles. But one of the things amazed me was members of the Knesset speaking at their meeting about the ultra-Orthodox religious people, the Haredim, in Israel, and how they were they had 20 bills they'd put in against free speech, independent judiciary, democratic institutions. They're pushing segregated buses in Israel, segregated sidewalks to keep women separate. It's equivalent to the extreme Muslim, of course not as violent, but that's changing, apparently, in Israel. The last election, for the first time, the new Yesh Atid party got 20 votes against 19 for the religious parties that have had tremendous control, almost, of the government. The new party wants to force the schools, 27% of Israeli children in yeshiva schools with no math, no science, no history. And this party wants to change the law to force the schools that are subsidized to teach those kind of subjects. Anyway, we're about evangelicals in America. It's a big part of the Republican base. I notice Oklahoma, Phil spoke about Hagel. Both senators in Oklahoma are against Hagel, which is a big evangelical state. It also is the place where most bombs are manufactured. So you get two for one, business, good business. The key arguments to attack Iran is often they're irrational. They're crazy. They want to go to heaven. With one bomb, they'll drop it on Israel and all get killed, but that's what they're looking for. Well, we have people who are as enthusiastic as that accusation. Tom DeLay spoke at the Christians United for Israel Hagee's conference. A young Jewish journalist, Blumenthal, went with a video and interviewed Tom DeLay, who thought he was speaking to a like-minded. And Tom DeLay says on the video, I live for the end times. He was three beats from the presidency. I live for the end times. I hope they come tomorrow. That can be found if you search DeLay Christians United for Israel video. So the video comes up, you'll find it. There's also an interview with the Israeli ambassador there who's asked about this. Well, what kind of alliance is this that they hope that Israel will bring about the end times, and Jews who don't convert will be killed by God? And the Israeli, do look at the video, you'll see his answer. Formerly, these evangelicals were not political. Reagan brought them into the political system. They were not because they thought the end times were coming sooner any day. It's getting a little long in the tooth because Israel was founded 60, 70 years ago. And the second coming has not yet come, so there's some meant to come sooner. The evangelical, I might add, the main issues, abortion, family values, homosexuality, school prayer, basic conservative issues. Chris Hedges and the New York Times religion correspondent has written books on this. The bitterness of many blue-collar whites, males particularly, have not achieved or are left behind in society. Whatever it is, they have an agenda which passes over in the political spectrum. The first evangelical I knew was Jimmy Carter, and he was a man of obviously very Christian principles, and a very sincere man, and I had a very high opinion of evangelical. But I would come from the anti-communist movement. In the anti-communist times, Reagan brought in the evangelicals, and that's why I met many, and I'm in meetings even today, heavily evangelical. There's a darker agenda, as Phil has explained, obsession with revelations, which I might add is a controversial issue. Martin Luther, the revelations is so contrary to the rest of Christ in the Bible that Martin Luther did not translate it when he published the Protestant Bible. So it's not, but many well-meaning Christians believe it. It's not the extreme here that is taken over by the Christian Zionist. There's different levels, premillennial. First comes Armageddon, and then they go to heaven, or the good ones go to heaven first, and then comes Armageddon. Different disputes. But I like the gospel music, and I listened to it, and I kept hearing all these happy people singing about going on a one-way trip. I thought going to New York or something. And then it dawned on me, of course, what it meant. And then you hear songs, a famous song, "I'll have the time of my life when the time of my life is over," and so on. So there's a great focus on that. They see the founding of Israel as helping, and if you go out west, you see movies on the TV, you'll see trying to collect money to bring Russian Jews to Israel. Because the part of the Second Coming involves most Jews, in some of the theories, have to be back in Israel. And then they also have to occupy the whole of ancient Judea. So that's where they want the settlements, they support the settlements on the West Bank, etc. The point is that obviously the Second Coming is not good for the Jews, it's an expression. Pat Robertson, one of the points I also make is they say often, they quote, God helps or loves those who help the Jews, but it's only Jews who make war. Jews who make peace are not, according to their theories. I quote Pat Robertson when Yitzhak Rabin was murdered. Pat Robertson said, well, he was getting in the way of God's will, as if God wants war. I mean, this kind of thinking, you see where it goes. The very successful series of books, Left Behind, was also made into a movie. I saw the movie. It starts in an airplane where a woman says to the stewardess, please, my husband, I can't find him, he disappeared. And the stewardess said, well, I'll look in the restroom. And the woman says, well, take his clothes, they're on the seat. And so then a mother starts screaming for her child, and the child is gone. Well, the good people have been taken to heaven. This is the way the movie starts. The bad people, including the co-pilot, I might add, the pilot was having an affair with a stewardess, so was not taken, and they landed safely. In any case, these are the kind of stories, but there's a lot of revenge fantasy. Vanity Fair did an article on this, a revenge fantasy in which right-wing Christians win out over the rational, scientific, modern, post-Enlightenment world. Liberals, gays, abortion, all driving Christ out of the public square. I might add the evangelical reaction sort of came when the U.S. government got into the schools, taking away prayer, the abortion, and so on. Another point, am I doing?
You have 4 minutes.
Okay. Another point is war. When I put my article out there, when Lieberman was the senator from Connecticut who lost the primary to a Democratic opponent, Lieberman is as far left as they go on pro-gay, pro-abortion, all the union issues, on all the social and economic. He's way out there. But the evangelicals then united to support him when he lost the primary, was running independent, and won again. he got big evangelical support. It was more important, a man who was very supportive of the settlements on the West Bank, of war, etc., was more important than all the social values. It's that strong a feeling. I think the point of all this is that we have well-meaning people of all religions, if you will, three, Muslim, Christian, and Jewish, well-meaning people. You now have an election in Israel where reaction against this. We have in America. We have to be focused on this issue and work together against these extremists that would really drive the world into chaos. And of course, not Armageddon, or perhaps, but hopefully many of us here and this session is giving some publicity to these kind of issues that are not on the public, on the media in any big way here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, John. Now our next speaker is going to be Norton Mezvinsky. Norton, like John, has been a friend of mine for a number of years. Norton is a professor of history emeritus at Connecticut State University. He's also the president of the International Council for Middle East Studies, and he's written a very well-known book on Jewish fundamentalism. It's called Jewish Fundamentalism in Israel, which he co-authored with Israel Shehak. Norton?
Thank you. Thank you so much. Historians are often concerned about definitions. Hence, I want to begin by adding a bit to the definition of Christian Zionism. In this discussion, we are dealing with evangelical Christian Zionism. Many other Christian churches, theologians, and individuals who have expressed agreement with and support of Zionism, the nationalist ideology that constitutes the heart center of the State of Israel's character, could also be considered Christian Zionists of different sorts. That is a topic for another day. Although a majority of evangelicals in the United States and some other places as well are Christian Zionists, a minority are not, and some, such as the renowned evangelical spokesperson Tony Campolo, actually are opposed to Christian Zionism. How many evangelical Christian Zionists are there in the United States? The estimates vary widely. Jerry Falwell, before he died a few years ago, said the number was 100 million. That was an exaggeration. In a recent op-ed piece in the New York Times, a commentator wrote that the number was 20 million. That is an underestimate. My research indicates that the number is at least 40 million and could be somewhat larger. Whereas a dispute may exist about the actual number, there should be no dispute about the fact that the evangelical Christian Zionists have established one of the most influential and efficient political lobbies in this country. The Christian Zionist lobby is at least as influential as the Israel lobby in maintaining and expanding American support for Zionism, the State of Israel, and Israeli policies regarding the Palestinian-Israeli, Arab-Israeli conflict. Christian Zionist groups and leaders lobby and pressure members of Congress, presidents of the United States, and administration officials with great success. Some Christian Zionists have become and are members of Congress and administration officials. They work diligently to keep the United States government solidly in support of the State of Israel. Public support in the United States for Christian Zionism has grown steadily during the past four decades. Indications of this are the enormous sales of popular novels espousing Christian Zionism. The late Great Planet Earth, written by Hal Lindsey and Carol Carlson, published in 1970, was the first of these. Over 26 million of this one novel had been sold by 1990. The number has almost doubled since then. the Left Behind series of 16 novels written by Tim LaHaye and Jerry B. Jenkins, published between 1995 and 2007, has sold tens of millions of copies in English and has been translated, published, and sold in other languages. Video and movie spin-offs of these novels have been produced and are still being watched. The garnering support for Zionism, the State of Israel, and policies by Christian Zionists stems directly from the theology of Christian Zionism. Briefly stated, Christian Zionism is one type of Protestant fundamentalism. It stresses the literal interpretation of the Bible and emphasizes the necessity of acceptance of Jesus Christ as the Son of God and as a personal Savior. In addition to that, Christian Zionism is the modern day advocacy of a particular theological system known as premillennial dispensationalism, which was initiated and developed in the early 19th century by the English clergyman John Nelson Darby and the Scottish clergyman Edward Irving. This advocacy blossomed in the United States. According to premillennial dispensationalism, world history is divided into certain periods or dispensations. As part of this construct, Jews must and will be either the sole occupants of or will be in full control of the Holy Land, which includes at least the entirety of today's state of Israel, before the second coming of Jesus, which in turn will follow Armageddon, called the mother of all Holocausts. During Armageddon, only the true believers will be raptured to safety above the earth, while all other people who will have followed the Antichrist who precedes Jesus will be killed. Some Christian Zionists say that only 144,000 Jews, that's out of about 15 million in this world, and according to the last census, about 5.7 in Israel, only 144,000 who will have correctly accepted Jesus as their Savior will be included among those raptured and saved. A few Christian Zionist leaders say that all Jews will be spared from death during Armageddon because they will immediately accept Jesus correctly when he returns to this world. Pastor John Hagee, perhaps the number one Christian Zionist leader, changed his original position a while ago and now agrees that Jews will be spared during Armageddon. According to some commentators, he changed because of his close connections with Israel's political leaders, the many awards and favors he receives from these leaders, the fame in certain circles he has achieved, and the large sums of money he continually receives as payment for his advocacy. Much more can and should be said about all that I have mentioned, but in the remainder of my presentation, I shall focus upon Christian Zionism and its views of Islam and Muslims. From the Christian Zionist perspective, Islam is an evil religion. The Prophet Muhammad was actually or is the equivalent to an agent of Satan, if not Satan himself. Thus, Muslim believers in and followers of Islam are dangerous. In regard to this latter emphasis upon Muslims who are American citizens, there are some differences among Christian Zionists. Acknowledging that American Muslims are at least potentially dangerous because they believe in and follow Islam, some Christian Zionists say that these Muslims need to be watched closely and need to be confronted, stopped, and even arrested when they do suspicious things. Other Christian Zionists literally wish to deny all Muslims many rights and privileges granted to other citizens. With few, if any, exceptions, all Christian Zionists warn against the danger of Muslims attempting to invoke Sharia, Islamic religious law, in the United States. Christian Zionists do not differentiate, as do some people, between what is often referred to as militant, radical, and extremist Islam, and what is termed by some as moderate Islam. For Christian Zionists, again, Islam itself, all of it, is evil. It allegedly preaches, according to these Christian Zionists, the killing of non-Muslims and the establishment of Islamic rule under Sharia law for the world. In their sermons, speeches, and writings, Christian Zionist pastors and other spokespeople clearly state that Islam is evil. They attempt to fortify their interpretations by specifying certain series or chapters of the Quran, using, of course, their own translations into English from the Arabic. Many examples of their writings, sermons, and speeches can be easily found on the internet. In citing surahs from the Quran, Christian Zionist leaders are often creative. They, for example, employ what they call abrogation, which they maintain means the removal of one verse or change of a verse with another newer verse to make something lawful in Islam, which was previously ruled unlawful. According to these Christian Zionist critics of the Quran, surahs or chapters, over 60% of the Quran contain abrogation. These Christian Zionist critics claim that the latter verses, which Muhammad allegedly received from Allah, supersede earlier verses. One illustrative example is that a surah saying that Jews and others will have a place in heaven, those surahs are superseded by a surah that only Islam will be accepted by Allah. Even more severe surahs, giving the impression that Islam is a kind and tolerant religion, are allegedly superseded and abrogated by later verses that call for waging war against all who do not believe in Islam. The Christian Zionist stated examples of abrogation are numerous. Since time limitations do not permit my citing as I would like to do, many statements from Christian Zionist leaders that emphasize the evils of Islam and the danger from and damage already committed by Muslims, I shall present one representative example, the essence of which has been and is still repeated over and over again by Christian Zionist spokespeople. Michael Evans, who is a widely acclaimed Christian Zionist spokesperson, he is also a best-selling author and has appeared on the BBC and United States major television networks, and has published articles in the Wall Street Journal and the Jerusalem Post. In his 2003 book, Beyond Iraq, The Next Move, he insists that Muslims were the modern-day representatives of the forces of Satan that must be crushed. He called Muhammad a proto-terrorist who banished and killed Jews for not believing in him. He claimed that terrorism is a logical sequence of Islam. He argued that the Qaddafis, Khomeinis, Bin Ladens, and Husseins of the modern day are disciples of Muhammad and Islam. He called Islam a malevolent manifestation of religion conceived in the pit of hell, end quote. He equated Islam with the Antichrist, against whom all Christians must fight with all the resources at their command. Again, what Evans has asserted in his book and elsewhere constitutes the Christian Zionist overall view of Islam and Muslims. Okay. Although I did not need to be reassured that what Evans has written and said correctly represents the Christian Zionist position, I was so reassured 2 weeks ago when I attended a discussion led by an evangelical Christian pastor with whom I have somehow established a working relationship. I told him that I intended to quote Evans in my talk today. He told me that he was speaking for all Christian Zionist leaders he knew, and he said, "Evans told the gospel truth." Although I knew it would not raise any question at all in his mind, I could not help but cite for him a Yiddish proverb from the many that my grandmother used to delight in telling us. And in a sense, that may be a good way for me to end my talk today. Here's the proverb. Der Emes lebnit, der Emes starbnit, der Emes matert sich. The truth is not alive, the truth is not dead, it struggles. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Norton. We're going to end now with Professor Fuad Shaban. He's the vice president of Yarmouk Private University in Syria. He's the author of Islam and Arabs in Early American Thought and For Zion's Sake, the Judeo-Christian Tradition in American Culture. He's spoken at a number of American universities.
I would also begin with a quotation from Genesis, where God says, I have not sent these prophets, but they went. I have not spoken to them, but they prophesied.
Am I correct?
Can you repeat that? I didn't hear it.
I have not sent these prophets, but they went. I have not spoken to them, but they prophesied.
Thank you.
Thank you. My colleagues. Yes. My colleagues have provided a clear picture of Christian Zionism, the evolution of its theology and politics, and its current attitude to Islam and Muslims. To complete the picture, it remains to provide a brief account of the historical and cultural genesis. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
It remains to provide a brief account of the historical and cultural genesis of Christian Zionism, and of the development of a few of its principal features in America. For I believe that some of the major features of Christian Zionism have existed in varying degrees throughout American history and have exercised a good deal of influence on America's religious as well as politics, on its relations with Arabs and Muslims. I should begin by clearly stating that what I will describe as features of Christian Zionism in the cultural historical context does not mean that early on in American history, these features can be described as full-fledged Christian Zionism in politics and theology as delineated by Dr. Mizvinsky. Rather, these are features that fed into what became in the second half of the 19th century Christian Zionism proper. Americans have always been occupied with eschatology and end time predictions and millennialism. Well, millennialism has been on the mind of many generations of believers in the States. Boston University historian Richard Lands said in a PBS Frontline Roundtable in 2001 that, and I quote, from the perspective of the millenarian historian, America fell in the millennial vat at birth and has yet to get out of it. As a matter of fact, I have researched literally hundreds of end time predictions made by Americans from the Puritan settlements to the present time. And a major characteristic of American millennialism is the belief that Providence has assigned a special role to America in the end time scenarios. Because of the time limits, I will emphasize two constant characteristics which have been instrumental in its theology and politics, especially in its influence on America's attitude to Islam. These two characteristics are, number one, the end-time eschatological scenarios, which are based on conceived prophecies in the holy texts of Christianity. Number two, the place assigned to Islam in these scenarios and the consequent attitudes and behavior towards Islam and Muslims by American Christian Zionists. It will be evident that these two features are interconnected by a reciprocal cause and effect relationship, and that they have increased in their dominance of some religious churches and denominations down the centuries. Although we speak of American Christian Zionism, American, we need to recognize that the seeds of this movement were part of American European heritage, that these seeds underwent a process of transmogrification into their patently American form. In the immediate and distant European background of both Christopher Columbus and the Puritan immigrants to the New World were memories of the Crusades, the Ottoman encroachments in the heart of Europe, and the recapture of Andalusia by Spanish and European forces by Ferdinand and Isabella. Furthermore, for the Puritan settlers, there was in the immediate background and in their actually past experience an added factor of their Protestant heritage, which has in it much more seeds of Christian Zionism. We need only mention the interpretations of biblical texts by Luther, Calvin, Zwingli, Bibliander, and others to see the connection drawn between Muhammad, the Pope, and the Antichrist with the end of the world. I should hasten to add that this is not a reflection on most of the mainstream churches in America today. In fact, a large number of Methodist, Lutheran, Catholic, and even Baptist churches and groups are very active in projects of peaceful coexistence and dialogue and in the place taking place in the Middle East. Eschatology and fear of Islam were both present side by side in all of these developments. When Christopher Columbus conceived of his enterprise of the Indies, he stated many times in his letters, journals, and in his unfinished book, the Book of Prophecies, modeled after the Holy Book of Prophecies, that his central goal was to defeat the empire of Muhammad and to recapture the Holy Land in preparation for the beginning of the millennial kingdom of Christ. In his letter to the Spanish monarchs, requesting their patronage of his enterprise of the Indies, Columbus promised to recruit the newly converted peoples in the battle of life and death against the empire of Muhammad. And in one journal, he states clearly his belief, and I quote, "God made me the messenger of the new heaven and the new earth in which he spoke in the apocalypse by St. John after having spoken it through the mouth of Isaiah. And he showed me the spot where to find it." It is in his repeated references to the promised land and the war with Islam in the context of biblical prophecies that I consider Columbus to be the first to introduce elements of Christian Zionism to the New World. In the 19th century, America witnessed a surge of populist religious activities, mainly the emergence of a number of churches and religious groups which based their theories on end-time prophecies and theories. Some of these are the Seventh-day Adventists, the Mormon Church, the Millerites, the Shakers, and others. All of these groups regarded political prophecy, biblical prophecies of the coming kingdom and the promised land essential to their beliefs. Furthermore, these groups in varying degrees regarded Islam and Muslims as occupiers of the Holy Land and thus enemies of Christianity and an obstacle to the fulfillment of prophecies. In 1810, just to give you a few examples, Jedediah Morse preached a sermon on prophecy in Charleston, Massachusetts, in which he predicted the collapse of the papacy and the doctrine of Muhammad to be followed by the restoration of the Jews and the Promised Land. And about a century later, Samuel Zwemer, in a lecture at Princeton, predicted that when the crescent wanes, the cross will prove dominant, and the disintegration of Islam is a divine preparation for the evangelization of the Muslim world. The first American biographer of the Prophet Muhammad, George Bush, explained that his grand object, and I quote, "My grand object of writing this biography was to exhibit the Arabian prophet as a signal instrument in the hands of Providence, to put the whole system of his imposture into the great scheme of divine administration of the world. Bush saw, and I quote, divine interposition and infinite wisdom in the rise and establishment of this arch delusion in the world. These factors in American religious life were accompanied by, or perhaps resulted in, a surge of missionary activities and campaigns, many of which centered in the Muslim world, the Holy Land in particular. One example, Henry Jessup, in his book, The Mohammedan Missionary Problem, and Jessup spent 53 years in Syria as a missionary. He was one of the people who established the Syrian Protestant College, came to be known as the AUB, the American University of Beirut. He said he saw a striking coincidence in the history of Islam and Christianity. He says, and I quote, at the beginning of the 7th century, there occurred two events of momentous importance. One was the rise of the Mohammedan religion, the other, the Christianization of the Saxon race in Britain. Jessup sees the hand of Providence in this historical coincidence. They, he says, were providential and related in the most intimate manner, as bearing on the welfare of the race and the future development of Christ's kingdom in the world. Jessup sees two other historical coincidences which were providentially related. He says, in the year 1492, the year in which Columbus discovered America, and thus helped in the Christianization of the Anglo-Saxon race in the New World, Ferdinand overthrew the last Spanish Mohammedan army, and Muslims were driven into Africa. This combination of factors, augmented by scores of end-time prophecies, brought about a clear emergence of the Christian Zionist principles and beliefs, emphasizing regaining the Holy Land from Muslims, the ingathering of Jews in the Promised Land, and the ultimate defeat of Islam in the Battle of Armageddon. And I can't help but remember that when I was reading one of the sites of the Christian Zionists called Gog and Magog, it predicted that before Armageddon, and in order to bring about the last days, Damascus, my hometown, will be a heap of rubbles. And I was wondering if my insurance policy on the apartment for which we worked many years will cover an act of God in the literal as well as the legal sense. But the modern phase and of the story of this Christian Zionism has been amply covered by my colleagues on the panel. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Fuad. I'd like to open the floor to questions now. Please, but let them be questions. If there's something you want to discuss with any of the four of us, you can talk to us afterwards. We're all very accessible by email, by telephone, and we'd be happy to talk to any of you. But let's try to get in as many questions as we can and keep them brief. Let's start over here, all right in the front.
You spoke about the very beginnings of the Christian Zionist movement in the 80s. About the same time President Reagan was in the White House, and I wonder if there was any official acquiescence between the semi-ending of the Cold War, using religion as a a changing force, or was it indigenous within the United States? And the fact that you also mentioned there was aid, and I don't believe you used the term, but I'm paraphrasing, that the U.S. aid was transferred, U.S. aid to Israel was transferred to the Christian Zionists to realize their goals. Now, wouldn't that be a prohibition under U.S. law to transfer aid?
Well, that's three questions. Let's go to the last one first. The issue of Christian Zionists receiving gifts from Israeli leaders when Israel receives a considerable amount of foreign aid from the United States and also receives charitable contributions virtually at an unlimited level, which are not challenged either by the Treasury Department or anyone else. So the question becomes, if that money is then used to influence the American political process, is it illegal? Well, it's illegal depending on how they do it. I would say giving an airplane to an evangelical leader is probably legal. But the fact is, if they're giving political contributions to a particular candidate like a Mitt Romney, that would be illegal. So I don't think that that, you know, it depends on how it's done. So which other question would you like to go first? Oh, with the Reagan administration. Clearly, Reagan was the one who saw an underserved constituency for the Republican Party in the Christian Zionists. I believe I'm correct in saying that there are probably some in the room who know better than I, that Reagan actually established in the White House liaison with evangelicals. I believe that was a first under Reagan. And so I think this was a purely political move. And obviously, it did good things for the Republican Party for a certain number of years in terms of getting them elected, but it's now turning around to bite them, because obviously this is it's become a legacy which brings with it a lot of things that the Republican Party maybe wishes it didn't have. So I think that would be the fairest answer to that. Norton, would you have another view on that?
Well, there may have been connections a little earlier. It may have been in the late 70s when in Israel the connection was first really made, with Menachem Begin being the prime minister and the evangelicals. And that's when Jerry Falwell started to get gifts and so on. That seemed to then be reflected some in the White House, certainly in certain specific ways. So I would say that's probably a background to what happened a little later in the Reagan administration. But do you want to go to his question about the first question?
Recommendations to the...
That's what I was going to. I was going to address what can be done about it. Very much events like this, publicizing it. I wrote an article, as you'll find on the internet, The Strangest Alliance in History, which is the evangelicals with the Likud and the settlers on the West Bank. It really is the strangest. Each side thinks it's going to gain from the other. Publicizing this, particularly publicizing the irrationality of it, it's not reported. Big media does not report these issues. I mentioned earlier, inside Israel, this growth of fundamentalist, the Haredim, which is close to the Muslim extremists, and also in their violence and their anti-democratic movement. This is public. That's not shown because the powers that be, if you will, the Israeli lobby, which is really today heavily, it's not even most Jews, I would say it's heavily dependent on the evangelical Christians and the military-industrial complex. That's what that lobby is today. But publicizing this, publicizing the irrationality of it, and doing the kind of things where it's hard to get through, but especially the illogic of this kind of an alliance.
John, can I just say one thing?
Yeah, sure.
I'd just like to fortify that and say one additional little thing as well, that actually for the last 3 years, if not four, I've been going around and talking about Christian Zionism around the country, a few other countries as well, but around the country. And what I've found is that even though there may be 30, 40 million evangelical Christian Zionists, there are very, very large numbers of people, including large numbers of Christians, who really don't know what the theology is, and they don't know what some of the actual practical effects are. And when they hear it, many of them are astounded and also upset. So I just want to underline, in a sense, what John Utley just said. And then I just want to add one other thing quickly. This is not just true, we all know this, that what I'm going to say is not just true with evangelical Christian Zionists. It's true with lots of people. The younger generation is, if not always, often more prone to be open to certain questions about positions, even positions in their community, than older generations. Now, when I've gone around to a number, I try to go to as many as I can because it's part of the research. When I go around to Christian Zionist groups and I go into discussions, I'm not asked to be one of the speakers, I can tell you that. Once in a while, I'm called upon to make a comment. But afterwards, there usually has been some significant groupings of young people who will come and talk with me. They're not so interested in me per se, but they're interested in the substance of what this is. So in ways that might be done creatively, and you can just go to meetings to try to target the younger generations, even of evangelical Christian Zionists, that might work.
Okay, thank you, Norton. Okay, I'm going to take this question on the left, and we'll go over to the right, and then we'll come back.
Yes, my name is Kami Bhatt. I'm right for the Pakistani Spectator. And my question is that how to bring reasonable voices on the surface, especially in the attention of media, from both sides? It's look like what you have just said about Islamic theory or Islamic philosophy, most of them happen to be true. I was raised up as a Muslim, Deoband Muslim. And they do believe, I mean in Pakistan, I'm from that country, they brainwash you as a child against Jews and against Hindus. And when you are raised up, you think that these people are responsible for every problem in Muslim world. So, and not only in third world, but even in the United States, John, you see Sohail Khan, people like this, these people are basically fundamentalist Muslim. And it doesn't matter what they disguise in this country, that's how they organize their organization in this country. And it, I mean, I know Tom DeLay, yes, he used to believe that, but there are so many Muslims who deep don't believe these kind of things, that they just changed the name from Jesus, they say it would be Mahdi, who would come, and then the Muslims who are true believers, they would take over almost everything or universe. So unless you have some reasonable voices against these people who have become very dominant, even in the United States, I'm talking about fundamentalist Muslims, they are really in there, and I have experience with them. I used to work on the hill. I'm one of those who started Muslim prayer on the hill. And these people are deep down, they are very fundamentalist Muslim. So, I mean, I used to make a lot of noise against Jews or against Christian, fundamentalist Christian, but once I learned about these people, I backed off. There is no point, because I don't see any difference between these Zionist Christian and these fundamentalist Muslim who are running the show in this country. Thanks.
And I said that the point is the media in America, we're speaking to Americans, well publicized the Muslim fanatic or extremist. It's not shown the other side. And I said in my speech, they feed off each other. There is a brighter side. The newer, most popular evangelicals in America, I think of Rick Warren, Joel Osteen, they don't preach like Falwell and Pat Robertson, the old men. I'm an old man, but it's really younger people change. And there's some good side, even in the American, in the Dallas Theological Seminary, I believe, Gary North, He's a Christian Institute for Christian Economics. He's the one who first put me on to the Muslim, the American evangelical Armageddon wanters. He writes that there's changes afoot among American evangelical. Dallas Theological Seminary now, of course, is that Armageddon will be postponed. So there are elements coming up, particularly younger people, as Norton says.
Yeah, and I would add, I mean, you know, we have a First Amendment that still functions in this country. The haters are always going to be with us, and their haters can be Christians, Jews, or Muslims. And we've certainly encountered all of those groups as haters. But the point is that when a hater gets into a position where he can institutionalize his hatred, or he can create policy around his hatred, then we have a problem. And that's why we think that we should be talking a lot more about the Christian Zionists as a concept in terms of their impact on American policy and on the American political system. And to go back to the previous question about how to combat this, you know, sunlight does an amazing thing. I mean, it comes in, and there's a lot of people talking about what exactly Christian Zionists believe. I think there are going to be a lot of people, a lot of moderate people in the United States that are going to be turned off by it.
Jeff, I'll start with you.
Thanks. A number of things that have been stated from the podium today were kind of amazing to me. For example, that a Gulfstream jet, John Hagee, has decided that all the Jews can survive the Armageddon, and a number of other examples. So my question is really this. Among the leadership of this Christian Zionist movement, I'd like to get the view of the speakers. To what extent are we really looking at a kind of a very cynical Elmer Gantry factor? I mean, clearly it was when the Likud came into power in Israel, which is not a particularly theological party, that there was a natural desire to ally with the Republican Party in the United States, especially in expectation of Reagan coming in. And I wonder whether, as part of the sort of pushback against this, whether it would be appropriate to sort of look at the much more sort of nasty and criminal elements of this alliance to poke some holes in the idea that somehow or other this is based on true theology as opposed to cynical political manipulation.
Well, I know what you mean, and you do have the example of John Hagee, but it's not quite so clear, Jeff, as you indicated. And let me speak about John Hagee for a minute. I've paid attention to John Hagee for at least a decade. And he is sincere in his theology, with one exception, and that exception happens to be the Jews. He's changed in regard to the Jews. Why? Because he's received not only a jet, but he now gets $60,000 per lecture when he goes around the country and lectures. I can tell you that for sure, because in July of this last year, a number of churches in Hartford, Connecticut, brought him to Connecticut. They paid him $60,000. They put him on the platform with Joe Lieberman from the state of Connecticut, and so on. Now, does that affect him? Undoubtedly, that affects him, but he's affected there with the Jews. In regard to his theology regarding, first of all, the theology with Israel fits in with this, but in regard to the theology, in regard to Islam and Muslims, he hasn't changed one whit, and neither have any of the other major Christian Zionist evangelicals who have espoused the same thing. So I would say to you, yes, there's something to what you suggested, but I would say, Don't feel that the theology is not what they believe. And let me cite something I've cited before quickly. A few years ago when I was in Israel and I talked to Israeli leaders and I said, don't you know about this theology. They gave me the answer that some of them were my relatives. They gave me the answer that I knew I'd get. They said, we think the theology is nonsense, but we're Machiavellian. We can understand that. Then I went to three Christian Zionist groups in Israel. They go for 2 months, 3 months, 6 months. And I asked them the same question. I got one answer from them, and from each of them got the same answer. And the one leader from one of the groups put it the best. And this talks to their theology. He said, listen, before I use the term, he said, we know that Israeli Jews think our theology is nonsense. That's what he said. But he said, we're not taking orders from them. We're taking orders from, and he did that. That tells you something.
Who was that?
Huh? That was a name. Wait, that was a guy with a name. I'll tell you his name. Interesting name that I'm not going to forget because it's a name with some Jewish overtones. His name was Joseph Abraham, and he was the head of one of these Christian Zionist groups. I wanted to ask him a little about Abraham since that's my father's name, but well, I didn't do that.
I'm sure he wasn't a Christian, a Zionist Arab.
No, he was not. No. Well, I don't want to utilize it. There's something to say about Christian Zionist Arabs, since indeed some of the people who hate Islam the most in this country use some people who are here, but they're Arabs. They use them as the ones that they say, they use those people to translate those surahs from the Quran that I cited. They use them and they say those are experts on Arabic, which they may be. So there are indeed some, as you, I'm sure many of you know, there are some people in this country and elsewhere who spread the greatest hatred of Islam who happen to be Arabs.
Just one note, Phil.
Oh, wait just a second. Let Fuad.
May I add just one slight modification here? And that's oversimplification, I think. I was talking to some of these Christian Zionists a while back, and I asked them, how do you square your idea that Christ will come back, will return, and the Jewish belief that Christ actually did not come, that he will come.
The Messiah.
But Christ, the one we believe in, Israeli was a quack. That's their belief. Now he said very simply, this is a marriage of convenience. We say Christ will return, and I know I'm oversimplifying the matter. We say Christ will return, and the Jews say Christ will come. The end result is the same. So let's not quibble over terminology.
Yeah, okay.
Thanks for the discussion. It's been really interesting so far. So you spoke about some of the Christian Zionist opposition to Chuck Hagel's nomination, and don't you think that the fact that he has walked back some of his positions on Iran and some of his comments that he's made, do you think that that suggests that he actually agrees with the Christian Zionist positions on some of these Middle East issues, and he
That's an interesting question. As none of us, I presume, were present in the room when he was doing this walk back, it was with a group of leaders of major Jewish organizations at the White House last week that this occurred. Whether he recanted in the sense that he admitted he was wrong, or I would prefer to think that he probably made the case that he doesn't set the policy in the Middle East or anywhere else. He works for the White House, that the White House policy would be XYZ. I would think if he's an honorable man, which I have every reason to think he is, that would have been the way he packaged it. But maybe someone here has heard something different.
Let me just add a point. The objections to Hagel isn't just this. It's the military industrial establishment in America. He said publicly, there's a lot of waste and load in the Pentagon budget. That happens to coincide with a lot of the Bible Belt, et cetera, the manufacturers. Like I said, Oklahoma makes bombs. But the point, mainly the attack on him, is the neoconservative, the evangelical, and the military-industrial complex that sees him as a threat to the establishment.
Okay.
I just came back from a trip with Rand Paul. Evangelicals took him to Israel, and while he was there, he made his own arrangements to visit with Abdul, what's his name, Hussein, Abdullah II, and Mahmoud Abbas, and some others. So he expanded. The idea of the trip, though, was, well, before I tell you what I think the idea of the trip was, I'd like to ask each one of you your impression of Rand Paul. Is he the kind of person that you think would be reliable as a candidate for the GOP nomination in 2016?
Well, as a matter of fact, I have an article coming out in the American Conservative on the website on Friday, which is an examination of Rand Paul's foreign policy record. And it goes into those issues. It goes into the visit to Israel. I don't know, to be honest. I mean, I was a strong supporter of Ron Paul, and I somehow feel betrayed by Rand. I think Rand is giving every indication of being a politician who wants to get elected president and is figuring out how to do that, and I think he has some advisors who are quite willing to help him with that process. So I don't know. I think the book is still open, but I would be a bit pessimistic at this point. I don't know how the others feel about it.
Let's move on to some more questions.
Uh-huh.
More questions.
Anybody else?
I have a question regarding the military-industrial complex and the goals for, obviously, continuing conflict and producing more guns and missiles and, getting money for it all. You mentioned that, the Bible Belt states, the senators that are opposed to Chuck Hagel's nomination. Who are they? Is Rand Paul, Kentucky, I believe, right?
Yep.
Is he one of them that would be opposed? And who else would you name as the senators opposed?
Well, we'll see very soon when the vote comes up for Chuck Hagel. But Rand Paul has indicated to cut the waste in the waste in government, the waste in the military. He's said the military budget has to be on the table. That's already a big move for any Republican, and it's hard for them. And I've written a lot. We have a website called the Military Industrial Congress Complex. If you just go Military Industrial Congress, which is the original term Eisenhower used, but it was shortened to Military Industrial. If you just search Military Industrial Congress, I have a website I set up 10 years ago with quotes of all this, which is very explanatory of all these issues.
Hi, thank you.
You're next. Yeah, human rights doesn't buy it, even with a Democrat. I think that the proper argument to use here is, there are two arguments. First one is that we can't afford it anymore. I think that's starting to resonate with everybody. And the second argument to use as a fallback is that really the way we approach these issues, whether it's Libya or Palestine or Iraq or Afghanistan or Syria, has produced no benefit for the United States. So you say the United States has been the loser on all these exchanges because of the policy, the way the policy is driven. Those were the two arguments that I would use. I don't know how the rest of you would see it.
Just as a detached observer of American politics, I stand in awe of democracy as it is practiced here, except for one thing. I get amazed when I see how American politicians of various degrees, and I may be stepping in where angels fear to tread here, how they go groveling to Israelis, how when the Prime Minister of Israel came to meet with George Bush in the White House, in his office, and George Bush suggested, just simply suggested, a cessation of settlements. And the Israeli Prime Minister, the Prime Minister of the smallest country in the world, I think, simply said, it's not gonna happen. It's not gonna happen. And yet, you see objections to the nomination of Hegel. And I think the main reason is this religious issue. In the states where democracy guarantees that everyone can practice his own religion, everyone is free, that there is a separation between church and state. As a person looking from the outside, I see this working very well, except when it comes to the relations with Israel and to relations with Arabs and Muslims. This is something which really amazes me all the time.
Absolutely, what you say is the question, if you didn't hear, is the attraction for simpler people or the many, many people who are passed by economic prosperity who seek solace that in all cultures, that was the question, all countries. I lived many years in the Third World, and I completely agree that that is the appeal. And I mentioned in my talk the various studies of the America, particularly in America, many evangelicals felt threatened by the government first, by the what they call anti-religious laws, the schools, the pervasive modern culture, which destroy, they feel undermines their morals. And that is the support for the movement. And certainly one answer is having better, more prosperity for everyone, but we can't do that. But that's the strength of the movement in all the different countries. As I also said, each the extremists feed off each other in every of the three religions. And that's the strength of it. It's harder to go ahead. You have another.
Yeah, I mean, Americans used to believe in national greatness, too. I mean, at the time of Kennedy, that was the thing. I mean, we all believed in a manifest destiny, if you want to talk about that, as Americans. But that, of course, died with Vietnam and with the social upheavals of the 60s and 70s. So that kind of went away. I think I owe someone on this side, right? Here you go.
Well, it depends on who they have listened to and are listening to. If they're listening to a good many of the right-wing Zionists, then they're hearing quite an opposite narrative from the one that you, Alan, have just stated. I'm not saying that the narrative they're hearing is correct, but the narrative they're hearing is how bad it's been for Jews in the Arab world, and that's why so many of them have left and come to the State of Israel, and they talk about how bad it's been, not how good it's been, and do they fabricate? I think the answer to that, and I've looked at a lot of this stuff, is definitely yes, but I'm now not talking about what is fabricated or not, or what's valid or not. They hear quite the opposite. And you don't have to go to Israel to hear it from right-wing Israelis. You can hear plenty of that, as many of you know, in the United States from many of the extreme Israeli apologists in the United States who will say the same thing. So I'm saying, look, I think that what you're suggesting in essence and in substance is correct. And let us assume for a moment that we're right in saying that. Well, if the question is, why do others not believe it, Jews and non-Jews, it's because they're hearing, again, as I've said, different narratives, and the people who are putting the different narrative, oftentimes, in many parts of our societies, they've done a better job of selling the case than those of us who would argue otherwise.
And again, if I may add a personal note here, I'm approaching 40 years of age, and I've lived most of this time in Syria, in Damascus. I do not remember one incident where we even knew that somebody is a Jew or a Christian. And this has been the tradition. Jews were so prosperous that when we as children were taken to a doctor, the Jewish doctor was preferred by our parents. They were a very well-respected and prosperous community in Syria. Now, in 1947, and I remember that very clearly, some of my friends in the high school, Jewish, they were saying, we are now threatened if we do not leave for Israel, because we are hearing, and they used to receive notes and letters by mouth through oral correspondence, that if you stay, then you are going to be blamed for what has happened in Palestine. And they personally told me, we have to leave. We cannot stay. We're threatened not by you and Syrians, but we're threatened by those who tell us that if we don't leave for Israel, then we will be subject to their attacks. This has happened. And the result is they left. Now the propaganda is that they were driven out of Syria and of the Arab world, that their lands, their properties were confiscated, and they had to leave. That did not happen. And I think the analogy of Jews being expelled from Spain, this is observed by many of the historians, Western historians, that they were given refuge by the Ottoman Empire, which is always accused of being extreme, anti-Christian, anti-Jewish. But this is, as Norton said, I think the ones who are louder usually get believed.
Okay, over here on the left. All right.
Thank you. Watched and observed this region, the Middle East region, for many, many years. It seems to be the significant problem in the Middle East is radical Islam. We have it in Pakistan. We have it in Afghanistan. We have scathing comments of Khomeini and Ahmadinejad from Iran about Israel and about the great state of the United States. We have problems, sir, in your country right now where 60,000 innocent people have been killed. Radical Islam has worked its way into Syria. We have a very serious situation in Yemen. There is a dislike between the Saudis and Iran. We also have a very difficult situation right now with the Muslim Brotherhood inside of Egypt. Israel's borders before the Arab Spring were relatively secure. We also have the Emir of Qatar, who just gave $400 million to Hamas, who will not acknowledge Israel's right to exist as a state. The other thing is, who does Israel make peace with? Abbas hasn't been able to deliver. Hamas certainly doesn't sound like they want to make peace. But all we hear is it's a Christian Zionist problem. They're the reason that there isn't peace in the Middle East. But if you look at the Middle East, it's obviously that that's not the problem. It's radical Islam.
Well, you're acting like there's only one problem in the Middle East, and that it's radical Islam.
I'm talking about the most extreme problem.
Please, can I finish?
Certainly.
Yeah, you're acting like Israel is not a player in creating its own problems. I mean, Israel has basically thrown away numerous opportunities for peace.
No.
The Saudi plan in 2003, there have been a number of overtures by Arab countries to try to make peace with Israel. Israel has always felt that, supported by the United States, it has basically a military monopoly and has been able to exercise that to keep the Arabs on their toes.
So what about Camp David in 2000, when Arafat had almost everything he wanted but the sovereignty over the...
That's been misreported. I'm not going to argue about footnotes and things here, but...
Our facts.
Well, let me just answer you by pointing the following out. Today we're talking about Christian Zionism, and I don't think I heard anyone up here, and this certainly includes myself, say that the problems in the Middle East were problems that were caused primarily or only by evangelical Christian Zionists. We were saying a lot of other things about connections, but we didn't say that, and I certainly wouldn't say that either. And if you would ask me, you and I are probably going to disagree, because I would say to you, the heart center problem is the Zionist character of the state of Israel, and that happens to be heart center rather than Christian Zionist. But that's it. Wait a minute, that's an issue, and that's a topic for another day, and I'm certainly willing to discuss that with you, but I'm saying it's not quite fair to say we said Christian Zionists have caused all the trouble in the Middle East. We didn't say it, and we don't believe it.
A key point is Arafat and Abbas turned down Barak and Olmert's generous offers.
Let's you and I talk about that together after the meeting.
Let's get another viewpoint. Michelle, you, and then you next.
I'd like to turn to the question of Jerusalem and the question of Jewish extremism and fanaticism. I've been studying a slice of Jewish fanaticism for a number of years, and where I've seen that the theology of Christian Zionism and Israeli fanaticism come together, Jewish fanaticism come together, is in the question of Temple Mount in Jerusalem. Now, I raise this because I think it puts this discussion in a non-academic setting, because what is being talked about by the Hilltop Jews, the illegal settlers, is blowing up the Al-Aqsa Mosque. This was also talked about by a member of the new Jewish Home Party that just won 12 seats in Israel when he came to the United States and spoke at a church in Winter Park, Florida, a Christian Zionist church. And they all come together in something called the Biblical Archaeology Review in London, which has been operating for years, and adds to the mix by saying that the third temple of Jerusalem is going to be part of this Armageddon and the second coming or the first coming and so forth. So this is live, it's now. Channel 2 Israeli TV and other valiant Israeli fighters against Jewish fanaticism and against the refusal to expand the settlements inside Israel are very concerned about this. And I'd like you to situate this war over Jerusalem in this context if you can. In my view, the Christian Zionists in America are actually funding terrorism by sending money to the settlers and so forth. And it's been going on for years, and there's not much done about it. So you've got the double standard, which is, I think, what we're all concerned about here. Thank you.
Well, Michelle, I mean, the quick answer to that is that sure, when Christian Zionists and others send money to that, ultimately winds up in the settlements and arms the settlers in some cases. We have, obviously, there have been reports of that. Yeah, you're funding terrorism, but the whole problem with terrorism is that it's an infinitely elastic word, and it depends on who's doing the definition. And I wouldn't consider necessarily groups like Hezbollah in their current situation to be terrorists. In fact, the European Union doesn't agree that Hezbollah is a terrorist group, but in the United States, it's universally described as a terrorist group. So anyway, it comes down to definitions, and it comes down to legalisms, and that's the problem.
Some of us know a lot about the Schofield Bible. Corruption of Well, obviously, there's a good deal to what you've indicated about the influence of money. But then I suppose the only way to try to determine this, and we know we can't crawl inside people's heads, and we can't crawl inside people's hearts. Sometimes the evidence is pretty clear about whether a person is sincere in religious belief or not, or sincere in something else or not, but oftentimes it's not clear. But I would say that the only way to really try to go at that is to take the people about whom we're talking or the leaders and look at them specifically. Now, I'm sure there are differences among evangelical Christian Zionist leaders. Are there some Elmer Gantries involved who are in it for the money? Even without knowing, we could say almost certainly yes. But does that mean that that is the case for all of them? I would say almost certainly we can say no. For how many? Maybe we can't say, but then we have to look at who they are, how they've been, and so on. We also know something else, or should know something else. Sometimes it's possible for a person to be influenced by more than one thing. That person can be influenced by sincere religious belief, as you put it, and also be influenced even a little more by some money that may come in. So it's difficult to measure, but again, I can only draw upon the studies that I've done and the research I've done and what I know from what many other people have done, and I think I can say with some assurance, or with some, I believe this, that a number of the leading evangelical Christian Zionists are sincere in their theology. And of course, the problem there is, as I think we all know, people who believe they are doing God's command and they're acting under God's orders, those people are extremely difficult to deal with if one wants to change their mind. And if they're doing things that we think are wrong and are bad, it's all the more difficult to try to convince them otherwise, because what human is going to be able to convince somebody who believes she or he is working in accordance with God's word? What human is going to be able to convince that person who sincerely believes that to believe or to do something opposite? That's the question.
One more here and then over there.
In fact, I don't have a question. I have just a recommendation for this gentleman here. I'm recommending that maybe he should read some of the Hebrew paper. Maybe he can distinguish between the official propaganda of the Israeli and government and the Zionist movement here, and between reality, what's going on, from Israeli Jewish writers.
That's correct. You get discussions of these issues in Israel that don't take place in the United States. I would recommend either the conservative paper, the Jerusalem Post, or Haaretz, which is much more liberal. But I read them every day.
I do too.
Yeah, I read them every day.
I spent 2 months a year in Israel, so
okay.
Well, I have a lot of Palestinian friends.
Okay.
I was curious to hear some of your recommendations, given that sort of the extent to which Islamophobia is an acceptable sort of viewpoint in mainstream American culture, especially post 9/11, and just kind of thoughts about the way that this is possible because Islam is not necessarily known, and so it can be characterized to an ignorant public as like a religion of Satan. So thoughts about how maybe to address that. You know, one thing I've heard recommended is, you know, maybe get wealthy Arab monarchies on board to kind of have more education about what Islam means, and also maybe the gentleman who was commenting on sort of fundamentalist Muslims in other parts of the world, that perhaps just greater understanding of religion across the board would help.
Well, I mean, a good first step would be to tell Congress to shut up, and but that's not going to happen. I was a CIA officer for 20 years, working on terrorism issues. And it's interesting to note that I started out in Italy and Germany in the 1970s. Terrorists were Europeans back then. So terrorism is not a uniquely Muslim characteristic. It's something that that groups that are powerless, relatively speaking, vis-a-vis their governments and vis-a-vis the security services, it's a tactic that they use. Now, the problem is that Muslims have been labeled with this: Muslim equals terrorists, Islam equals terrorism. This is a false equation, just like the arguments about Sharia law taking over the United States is a false argument. What I would say to you is, you know, let's build some consensus to be respectful of what everybody else is saying, but let's discuss the issues in a serious way and in an honest way. And Peter King, for example, with his congressional committees looking at the Islam and to deport Muslims and to take away their civil rights and stuff like this, this is the wrong way to go about it. I mean, it's not exactly, we don't criminalize other groups in the same way as we do Muslims. But my viewpoint, I guess, would be that we need a lot more airing of these issues in the media. We need a lot more groups like this getting together and just talking about them and seeing where we can come up with, what we can come up with at the end of the day.
A suggestion. I have become addicted to watching television on Sunday and all of these Christian evangelist programs. And I defer to our psychologist here. Literally thousands of people listen to these people, listen to the preachers when they say Islam is evil, Muhammad is a terrorist. Those thousands, many of them are really well educated, and they have their, you know, a background of intellectual achievements. How do you counter that kind of mass propaganda? To me, that's the problem. And I cannot but say that we Muslims have our terrorists. We have groups. I shy away from the term fundamentalist, because fundamentalist in Islam, a fundamentalist is a person who goes back to the sources of religion, not to any interpretations, any extreme interpretations of the text. Now, it's been now known here as a fundamentalist Muslim is a radical Muslim, is a terrorist, is a, you know, evil. Be that as it may, but we do have our terrorists. And I think the silence of the majority of Muslims against those radicals, extremists, encourages them, just as the silence here that I see against those radicals. Now, when I look at the video which John referred to of the meeting, the Christian Zionists for Israel, where I looked at the people who were there. Now, there was Joe Lieberman, there was Tom DeLay, there was Santorum, and a few others of people who are legislators in the States. And Tom DeLay said, I wish it would come tomorrow. I'm waiting for the day. And the interviewer jokingly said, would you give me your car before you go? He said, yeah, definitely. Now, this used to be the leader of the majority in the United States House of Representatives. I can't understand how a person who is a legislator, who is supposed to be the referee of separation of church and state, can be of this mentality. And that, I think, is a fault with the system. because there aren't as many voices that would correct this tendency.
Okay. All right, well, thank you all very much for being here with us today.